We will read Amos chapter 4.
Hear this word, you cows of Bashan, who are on the mountain of Samaria, who oppress the poor, who crush the needy, who say to your husbands, bring wine, let us drink. The Lord God has sworn by his holiness, behold, the days shall come upon you when he will take you away with fish hooks and your posterity with fish hooks. You will go out through broken walls, each one straight ahead of her, and you will be cast into torment, says the Lord. Come to Bethel and transgress. At Gilgal, multiply transgression. Bring your sacrifices every morning, your tithes every 3 days. Offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving with leaven. Proclaim and announce the freewill offerings. For this you love, you children of Israel, says the Lord God. Also I gave you cleanness of teeth in all your cities and lack of bread in all your places. Yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. I also withheld rain from you when there were still 3 months to the harvest. I made it rain on one city. I withheld rain from another city. One pot was rained upon, and where it did not rain, the pot withered. So two or three cities wandered to another city to drink water, but they were not satisfied. Yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. I blasted you with blight and mild dew. When your gardens increased, your vineyards, your fig trees, and your olive trees, the locusts devoured them. Yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. I sent among you a plague after the manner of Egypt. Your young men I killed with a sword, along with your captive horses. I made the stench of your camps come up into your nostrils. Yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. I overthrew some of you as God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah, and you were like a firebrand plucked from the burning. Yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. Therefore, thus will I do to you, O Israel, because I will do this to you. Prepare to meet your God, O Israel. For behold, he who forms mountains and creates the wind, who declares to man what his thought is and makes the morning darkness, who treats the high places of the earth, the Lord God of hosts is his name.
Amen, amen. No, it's we are reading for the fourth chapter today. So far, you know, we can see the heart of the Lord. So last week we saw, so about God is now warning the nation of Israel to return to him. So that is the, you know, the loving father asking his children to return to him. You know, when return, they will receive the blessing of the Lord. Also, they will take the protect from all the destruction is going to come for the nation of Israel. So again, the prophet, he is continuing his prophecy about the nation of Israel. So then, you know, he said, hear this word, you cows of Bashan. So, you know, the Bashan, it's a very fertile city. It's one of the city in the nation of Israel. It's a very fertile, and it is in the northeast of the Sea of Galilee. Okay, this is the Sea of Galilee. So, the prime grassland area renowned for its cattle, you know, it's a very beautiful grasses, so it's a rich, and when the cows they go here, they will be very fertile and they will be very wealth. They eat, the cows are very fattened. The cows growing in this city. So here God said, "You cows of Bashan, cows. You know we know bulls is the male and the cows is the female. So here God is calling his children, the women of the nation of Israel, as a cow. You know, when we do evil or disobey to our parents sometimes they call as a cow or like that. Here a loving father, he is calling the women of Israel as a cow of Bashan. You know, such a pain with the great agony and inviting them to return to the Lord. God is mentioning, you cows of Bashan, who are on the Mount of Samaria. So why God is calling them? the women as the cows. So because here God said you oppress the poor and also you crush the needy. They are not bothered about the poor people living in those in the area, and they are oppressing and they are not providing the need for the needy people. You know, when people, you know, in India, when the poor people, when they came for beg in our houses, they will call amma, mother, they will call, because you know the idea is the mothers are little soft hearted towards the mankind. But here the women in the nation of Israel, they are hard hearted, their heart is very hard, and also they want to live a luxurious life. You know, here they say, who say to your husbands, bring wine, let us drink. You know, when somebody allow the overeating, and after the overeating, and that took over, go away from the Lord to drink wine. And when somebody drank wine, they will, if you read Proverbs 31:4, so the mother, the Solomon's mother, he advised his son, you know, Lemuel is a name, one of the name for Solomon. So here the mother said, oh Lemuel, it is not for kings to drink wine, nor princes intoxicating drink. So if somebody, you know, in the parties, you know, for example, today the parties, they serve good food, also they serve all the wine and drink to the people to intoxicate themselves. If somebody intoxicate themselves, here the Bible said, let they drink and forget the law and pervert the justice for all the afflicted one. So they forgot, you know, overeating and also drink wine, they forget all the law of the Lord and leads injustice. You know, that's why, you know, the parties, office parties, or you know, somebody birthday parties, they serve all kind of drink to people, good food to people, you know, to forget everything, to think about evil or talk about the evil things. So here, so the women in the Israelites, they said that to their husband, get wine, we want to drink, we want to enjoy. You know, if you read 1 Timothy 5:6, so it's a she who lives in pleasure is dead while she lives. That is a very, you know, very big word about to condemn about the women. So today the people, they want to live a luxurious life, pleasure. Today pleasure, you know, wherever we go, people always talk about the food, people always talk about the vacations where they spent, you know, they will talk all the things, the pleasure of the world. Nobody talk about the law of the Lord, nobody talk about the goodness of the Lord, nobody talk about the love of the Lord, even in the church today, you know. So because of that, you know, God called them, you cows of Bashan. So cows of Bashan. And you can read, you know, sometimes people used to wonder, you know, especially in this land, Christians used to say, you know, it is not harm, you know, you can give, you know, drink small cup of wine, not intoxicate fully drunken, you know, you can have a limit to drink wine, and we can have steady life and like that, you know. But Bible says, you know, if you read Revelation 1, so God is calling you and me, his kings and the priest. So God is calling you all, we always, Christians always, we claim, oh, we are kings, we are priests. But you and me, when God call you and me as his king and priest, so the word which Proverbs 31:4 will be applicable to us. So that is the advice for the mother the mother, she is advising to his son, a king. So if a king drank the wine, he drank the wine, he forget the law of the Lord, and he will do all injustice, justice. So today, the Christians to know the call of the Lord, is kings and priests. It means you and me not to defile our body. You know Daniel, he lived in the pagan nation. Though he lived in the pagan nation, he decided, I don't want to defile my body by eating the unclean food, the food offered to the idol. So that is he decided in his mind. Because he took the decision in his mind, God blessed him. So here, God called the nation of Israel to be the witness. You know, last week we saw God called them. Because I know you, I want to call God, call you and me to be the witness for the Lord. You and me to be the witness. So you and me to always think about the law. Think about the law. Meditate the Lord, the law of the Lord. To always, when we do something, you know, we should do based on the scripture written in the word of the Lord. And also, you and me to help poor. So when we overdrank, when we intoxicate our body, we will forget the poor people and will crush needy. We need money. You know, we need money. So we will crush. You know, that's the bottom line. You know, for example, if you see somebody, they were addicted to something. For example, the drug addiction. Or if they are addicted to the wine. If they don't have money, what they will do? So they will ready to kill somebody. You know, that's why the homeless people, they sometimes used to kill. Why? They are intoxicated by some drug. They are addicted. If they don't have the drug, they will kill somebody. You know, recently, probably you might read in the article, even the California, the state of California, you know, the homeless people are addicted in the drug. So during the shutdown, you know, they don't have any money. So what the evil government in California, what they did, instead of providing food, they gave drug to the people. You know, it's a evil. So the heart of the government is evil. So when somebody, they are addicted, they will ready to kill, suppress somebody. So the nation of Israel, because the women's, they want to get more money, they want to live pleasure, they will influence their husband. You know why God is saying the women is the one, they will be kind of quiet in the houses, but they will influence their husband to get more money. So if you read, you know, Amos 5, chapter 2, 5 and 6, so God is warning the men's. Can you read Amos 2, 5 and 6?
But I will send a fire upon Judah and shall devour the places of Jerusalem.
Mm. 6.
Thus says the Lord, for three transgressions of Israel and for four, I will not turn away its punishment, because they sell the righteous for silver and the poor for a pair of sandals.
Mm. So in that word, you know, 2:6, almost 2:6, it is about men. God is condemning the men. You are selling the poor people for small money. So the women's in the home, they are influencing the husbands to get more money, to live a luxurious life. You know, if a woman went away from the Lord, you know, the home is gone. So that's why, you know, if you read Psalm 127:1, unless the Lord builds the house, so God is the builder of the home. And also, if you read Proverbs 14:1, the wise woman build her home, So if you take these two verses, you know, God want to build a home, so he give the heart to the women, the women. So that's why, you know, God, the women, they reflect the heart of the Lord in the women, in the home. You know, women is the one, they will bind their children and the family together with love. So if the women, but if the foolish pull it down her hands. So but if it is she is fool, she will destroy her home by her own hand. Own hand. Today, you know, because the evil, the people, they want the women's, they want to enjoy the pleasure of the world. You can see a lot of divorce because of that. So, you know, because, you know, they want to live a luxurious life. Whatever they want to get it. Because of that, they don't want to be under the authority of somebody. They want to live their own life. So it is very sad. But the foolish pull down her hands. So today, a lot of, you know, we can hear about the divorces. Marriage, they end up with divorces. So it means they are destroying their own family with their own hand. Own hand. That is the evil. That is the spirit of evil. If somebody possessed by the evil, you know, we can read in the gospel, when Jesus, he delivered a man holding 1,000 legions. So the man, he destroyed his body himself. Nobody destroyed. He himself took the stone and he put and destroyed his own body. That is the man who possessed evil. So if somebody destroy the family, if somebody destroy the nation, they are possessed by the evil people. So if you read, you know, Psalm 22, 12, you know, can you read Psalm 22, 12? So here, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, you know, in the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, the bulls of Bashan, they want to, can you read? Yeah.
Many bulls have surrounded me, strong bulls of Bashan have encircled me.
Amen. So many bulls are surrounded. So the people, those who are possessed by the evil, they surrounded the Lord Jesus Christ during the crucifixion. They surrounded the Lord, they beaten him, they want to crucify him. So here, you know, Psalm 22:12, it's referred the soldiers of the Jewish people. The Jewish people, they want to destroy the Lord. So if, why they want to destroy, why want to kill the Lord? Because he is their Messiah. He came with a great love to show his love, to call the people for repentance. But they want to get rid of him. They want to crucify him because they possessed by the evil. The spirit of evil, they overtake that people and they came against the Lord. So the same way, here, the women, they are, though they want to live a luxurious life, they are possessed by the evil. And they want to do all evil things. You know, it is very sad. So if somebody possessed by the evil, so they will do all evil things. So if you read verse 3, you know, 2 and 3, we will read it after some time. So here God said, come to Bethel and transgress a Gilgal, multiply transgression. So this is the Gilgal. Gilgal, you know, when Israelites, they came from Egypt, they passed the Jordan River. And when they pass, they put their step in the, you know, this is the landmark for Gilgal. So this is the entrance for the Canaan. So they place their foot in the Gilgal. So we know, you know, this is the very important place for Jewish people, because they step in the city first. So then Bethel, we know when he on the way away, go away from his brother, flee away from his brother, he met the Lord in Bethel. So Bethel is the he got a great vision. So we know in Genesis. So these two places, Bethel and Gilgal, you know, some of the important places for the Jewish people. So when the evil king, if you read in 1 Kings 12:25, Jeroboam, so after Solomon, the kingdom was divided into two, the 10 tribes, nation of Israel, and the two tribes, Judah and Benjamin, they took the name for Judah. The 10 tribes, they took the name for Israel. So in the Jeroboam, what he did when he got 10 tribes, God made him to be the ruler for the 10 tribes. So what the evil man he did, so he thought, you know, when the kingdom was divided, he thought when the people of the Israel, when they started to go to the temple, the Jerusalem, for worship, he thought when they started to go to Jerusalem, they will come against the king. So he want to keep his power by his own idea. He forgot the power which he got, the 10 tribe, it is from the Lord. But he got, I want to keep my power. So what he did, he erected the idols. So if you read here, he set up he made the calves and he put it in the one in the Dan and another one in the Bethel. So he placed there and he misleaded the nation of Israel, and he said, these are the images you Israelites brought you from the Egypt. So you know somebody, some leaders, if said openly, plainly said, people today, they will, without knowing, though they know everything, they want to please their king and they want to follow their king. So then they started to go to these areas and they started to worship the idols. So they corrupted, and Bethel and Gilgal, where they will go, and instead of worshiping the Lord, they started to worship the cows, the idols there. And also he took all the festivals, you know, they have all the tradition. So he replaced the Lord with the graven images and all the rituals, you know, which God asked them to do, they followed, you know, the rituals, the tithe and the sacrifices and the free will offering, you know, all these things you can read in Leviticus, you know, all these things they started to follow. But only he replaced the law. You know, God, the Lord, he is the one ask how we want to worship him. So, but somebody replaced the Lord and follow the tradition, it is kind of evil. You know, for example, today the services, you know, we have tithe, we are bringing tithe to the churches, we are worship services, we have all the activity, children activity, kids activity, we have all the activity, but when the presence of the Lord is not there, a repentance is not there, so we are replaced the Lord with idols. We put our own ideas. You know, today, you know, the church of the Lord is corrupted by the corporate idea. He adapted the corporate idea. Our corporate idea, you know, this minute it will be there. This is a corporate idea. So we are, today church are corrupted the corporate idea, and we left the Lord. But the heart of the Lord is, you know, to worship Him with truth and holy. So here God said, you know, if you read Matthew 5:23, therefore, you know, Jesus, He said, if you bring your gift to the altar and then remember that your brother has something against you, leave your offering, leave your gift there. You no need to offer your gift to there. Leave it and go and reconcile with your brother. That is Lord Jesus Christ. So today we won't preach about reconciliation with brothers and sisters. We won't talk about the repentance. Just we want to talk about the sacrifices. We want to talk about the tithe and offering. So we replace the Lord. Today, the church of the Lord, we want to learn. We replace. You know, even within our family, we can easily replace the Lord. Easily replace by thinking something. You know, people, our own tradition. You know, we used to say, this is our tradition. We follow this kind of things in our families. We got all this tradition from our forefathers. So we will follow the tradition. We won't leave the tradition. You know, tradition, it won't take you and me to the presence of the Lord. You know, tradition is the man-made. So they follow all the tradition, but they forgot their maker. They forgot the Lord. You know, today a lot of churches in this nation, even in our, in India, so we replaced even the Christian families. We can replace the Lord. We can do all the, you can do worship, you can sing songs, you can read Bible, but we can easily deceived by the evil by replacing the Lord. You know, in the Garden of Eden, God spoke to Adam and Eve, you should obey. If you eat the fruit, the forbidden fruit, you will surely die. So what Satan, he did? Exactly, he said, you know, if you eat, you will be like God. You know, just deceived. So, you know, when she deceived and she ate the forbidden tree and she went to brought the wrath of the Lord. So here, because, you know, the heart of man is always, we want to, for this you love you children of Israel. You know, for example, you know, when we call for prayer, fasting prayer, and also we will invite people for prayer with good party, good food. So people will prefer, which one they will prefer? They will prefer prayer with big party. They won't go to the fasting prayer. You know, the same way, we like it. So we will say, oh, we are also going and praying for some time. We will pray for probably spend 1 hour for prayer or Bible study. Then we will eat for several hours and then we will chat about somebody. Then at the end, we will end up with all evil things. But, you know, this is why, you know, all the people, we like it. But, you know, because we live in the dark world, we are influenced by the spirit of evil. The spirit which we, you know, the living in the world, the always, you know, all the flesh always to want to eat good food. The flesh always pulling us down. That's why Jesus said, your spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. So you and me, the flesh to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. That's why the, you know, we have the great, the third person in Trinity, the Holy Spirit. So when he comes, the Holy Spirit will control ourselves. So he will make us to understand what the Lord loves. He will put the love of the Lord in our heart. So here, the people of Israel, they want to follow all the tradition. They will celebrate, in our Christian term, they will celebrate Christmas, they will celebrate Easter, they will celebrate all festivals. But they don't have the Lord in their heart. That is the sad thing. You know, today, the church in this nation and throughout the world. But God is calling them to come to Him. So you and me too, very careful not to deceive by the evil. So here, God continued the invitation. Then God said, also I gave you cleanness of teeth, and in all your cities, and lack of bread in all your plagues, yet you have not returned to me. You know, the Lord, the heart of the Father, the children to return to Him. They want to come to home, to be with Him, to receive all the blessings which the Lord stored for His own children. So that is the heart of the Father. But the children, they want to away from the Lord. They don't want to be with the Lord. They want to be with their father. They want to go, you know, the prodigal son, we can read. They want to be with his father. They want to spend all the money, wealth. And here, but the heart of the Father, when the nation of Israel, they started to drift away from the Lord. They drift away from the Lord. You know, somebody, if their focus is not upon the Lord, so they started to drift little by little. So now, you know, if you read Genesis chapter 3, so when Eve communicated with Satan. So after he started to communicate with Satan, she started to shift away from the presence of the Lord. Probably when the first response, the Holy Spirit probably, He prompted in her heart, you should not talk with evil, the Satan. He will deceive you. You should flee from him. The Spirit of God might make evil to understand. But he quenched the word of the Lord, the Holy Spirit. She quenched after, if somebody hardened their heart. So God allowed for destruction. It's same thing happened in the Garden of Israel. Garden of Eden. The same thing happened in the nation of Israel. Today the same thing happening in the church. You know, that is the saddest thing. So as the church today, we are going away from the Lord. Because we are going away from the Lord, the first thing God sent, famine. You know, the clean teeth, they are lack of food. They don't have food, they lack of food. Then God allowed, withdraw the rain, the blessings, all the spiritual blessings, all the material blessings, withheld all the blessings. And yet, they are not returned. You know, today in this nation, more than 2,000 churches are closing every day because lack of money, because they couldn't maintain the church. So God sent the famine to the church. Why God allowed? He is a rich God. He is Almighty God. He can provide the church to let them. But He is the one withheld all the blessings. Why? The expectation of the Lord is people to return to Him. People to put all the things right. To put everything, evil things away from them, to return to Him. But today the church of the Lord, they hardened their heart. Hardened their heart. And the famine, the second thing God sent, the pestilence. Pestilence, you can see, you know, 9 and 10 about the pestilence, the plague. The plague, God sent, allow the plague to take over the land of Israel. So even then, God already we know in Joel, talk about the locust. And they harden their heart. They don't want to return to the Lord. They don't want to return to the Lord. They harden their heart. You know, can we interpret this today's church? You know, God allowed the famine in the church. The numbers in the church is reducing day by day. You know, if you put Google, the church attendance numbers is reducing. Today the 10% the people are going to church, attend the church. It's so much drastically reduced. But if you look upon the atheist, you know, atheist is increasing. The numbers in this land is increasing. So the people, those who stop not to go to the church, they are converted to atheism. Because the church, there is no life. Because the church, they are not move of the Holy Spirit. If somebody not allow the Holy Spirit to move in their midst, it is a dead. You know, if somebody is not having the Spirit of Christ, is the dead man. So because there is no life in the church, the people, they don't want to follow the empty tradition every day, every Sunday. You know, our mind is programmed. Our mind is programmed. If we are not able to attend the church Sunday service, what we will think? So we will think, oh, why I am not able to go to church? They will think, oh, something will happen today because I am not able to attend. It is our mind is programmed. It is a rituals. But we are not repent in our heart. We can go to church every Sunday. You can go to day, every day. There is no repentance. It is waste. It is vain. It is vain. So here the expectation of God is, God allow the famine. God allow the plague, make the people to repent. So today God withdraw the reduce the church numbers. Also today God allowed the coronavirus to take over the nations. Even then people are hard hearted not to return to the Lord. Not to return to the Lord. We know, you know, Christians, we know why God came, why God allowed the plague. We know, we have the Bible. We know our history. The God, same God allowed the plague in Egypt. The same God allowed the plague in Israelites, the disobedience. The same God allowed the plague to the land. So we know this is because of the land. So all these things, inviting the believers, the so-called Christians, to return, to come with broken hearted, to repent. You know, repentance, you know, in the Old Testament, they will tear their clothes and they will sit in the ashes and they will mourn. The same thing, you know, today, you know, we know about the plague. So the expectation of the Lord is, the church of the Lord, the believers, they will come together and they will sit in the presence of the Lord, fast and pray and ask the Lord to forgive their sin. That is the expectation. But I didn't see not most of the churches repented. Probably few people, they probably thought it is because of the sin. And the sins always lead to repentance. So that is the expectation of the Lord is. You know, if you read Ezekiel 33:11, could you kindly read Ezekiel 33:11?
as I live, says the Lord God. I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his ways and live. Turn from your evil ways, for why should you die, O house of Israel?
Amen. That is the heart. You know, God is inviting them. Why you want to die? Why you want to die? You want to repent to me. We want to return. That is the, you know, I want to make the people to, that's why God is waiting today. God is waiting the church of the Lord to repent. If you read 2 Peter 3:9.
The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance.
Amen. That is the heart of the Lord. You know, God wants everyone to come to know him, to know him, to acknowledge him with a repentance. It's a broken hearted, to washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. That is his heart. So that's why he is so patiently waiting. You know, sometime when we see the news, the things happening in this nation and throughout the world, and things happening in the churches and things happening in the Christian families, you know, it makes us to why it is happening like this. Why God is sometimes, we ourselves will be angry that things happening. But God is so patient. He is waiting the people to repent to him. The church of the Lord to repent to him. The families to repent to him. Repent to him. That is his expectation. The God, when he ride on the donkey, he invited the nation of Jerusalem. He called, he cried, oh Jerusalem, I want you to come to me. But there is no heart to come. That is the heart of the Lord. You know, today you and me, to understand the heart of the Lord, that is the heart. You and me to pray for people not to perish. Lord, make the people to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. So that is the you and me as a believers, we should not condemn people. Oh, all these people will do all these things. That is not our call. You and me to understand the heart of the Lord. How the Lord is a loving father, is opening his arm to inviting his people to repent to him. Though they are going away from the Lord. So you and me as a children to understand the heart. And to pray and plead the Lord. You know, that's why when the presence of the Lord, Moses understand the heart of the Lord. God want to destroy the Israelites in the Mount Sinai. But in the presence of the Lord, Moses understand. God, you are full of love. You are full of love. Probably I believe in the Mount Sinai, Moses is to understand the Lord Jesus Christ. He saw the backside of the Lord. Because the things going to happen upon him on the cross of Calvary, he probably understand. He understand the heart. Because he understand the heart, he plead at his feet, Lord, have mercy upon your children. He plead. So today, the invitation for the non-believers is, God is inviting them to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And the believers is, you and me, to pray and plead for the people, those who are perishing. So here, the loving Father is waiting. Her heart, you know, if you read the verses, you can understand the heart of the Lord. Understand the heart of the Lord. You know, Jesus Christ, he demonstrated his love on the cross of Calvary. Even then, today he is waiting people to repent. You know, Jesus said to his disciple, you know, I will drink the wine. In the Last Supper, he said, I will drink the wine when I will see all of you in the kingdom of the Lord. Why? You know, wine is the, you know, one of the, you know, the, when they are happy, the Israelites, they will drink the grape juice. That is the, you know, we used to have small party when we are happy. So they will drink wine. It's a grape juice. But Jesus said, you know, without you, without the church, I'm not having any party. I'm not sitting in the throne to live a pleasureful life. No, today Jesus Christ is standing at the right hand of the Father and He is pleading for the church. Pleading for the church. Father, have mercy upon your children. Have mercy upon your children. Father, give some time to these people. Give some time to this church. Give some time to the nations. Give some grace. That is He is doing. So when you and me understand the heart, without our knowledge, we should plead for people. That is the heart of the Lord. So you can read in Revelation 3:19 also about the heart of the Lord. So here, the loving Father waiting His Son, His children to repent. And so if somebody hard-hearted, if somebody took the patience of the Lord for their own benefit, you know, today people started to preach, God is so love. God is so love. He is so grace. So He won't judge people. He won't judge people. He will took everyone to the heaven. You know, this is the evil people. Evil people. If God want to forgive Adam and Eve, you know, Adam and Eve, if you take them, you know, they disobeyed in the Garden of Eden. A simple sin. They didn't ask the Lord whether they can eat or not. They can ask the Lord for a second opinion. Or they can ask the Lord. But they disobeyed. Simply they disobeyed. The disobedience brought the Lord came down to die for the sin. Die for the sin. Sin is such a huge, huge evil thing in the presence of the Lord. So if, you know, today, God is so patient. His patience is people to repent. People repent. Not, you know, whatever you do, let it go. No, that is not. Because when God brings judgment, it is very drastic. We can see the judgment and of the nation of Israel. God said, you know, God has waited for them for several hundred years, the nation to return to the Lord. Probably around 500 years, He waited. He sent several prophets. He raised several people. And the people, they hard-hearted. They went away from the Lord. So then God brought judgment. Verse 2. The Lord God sold by his holiness. God said, you know, I am a holy, He's a person, He's a holy God. So God guarantee that judgment is going to come. But still, you know, God has sent the word to the nation of Israel. The heart is when they hear the judgment is going to come upon the nation, they will repent. Repent to the Lord. You know, today the nation is facing the problem and economic crisis and the civil war. All these things happening. So the church is not ready to return to the Lord. You know, nobody. I never see any churches, big churches. Oh, let all the Christians let together. We'll have a fasting and prayer. You know, it nobody called like that. So here, then God said, you know, I am going to bring judgment. God guaranteed that judgment would become a reality. Reality, the judgment which God pronounced against the nation, it is going to come. Because the holy God does not lie. God is never changed. You know, God never changed. Jesus Christ is same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. You know, we can read about God, the Holy Father. God, He Himself said, I never change. So never change, God never changed. But God brings judgment. God is the righteous judge. Because He is holy God, He does not lie. We can always rely on His word. His word is 100% truth. We can rely because He is holy. He cannot lie. He cannot lie. He is a holy God. He is a righteous God. He is a righteous God. His throne is righteousness and justice. That is His throne. So here He is not, does not lie, nor can His holiness allow sin to go unpunished. Sin to be punished. Adam and Eve, they disobeyed. God punished. God brought judgment. The nation of Israel, they disobeyed. They forgot their maker. So God brought judgment. So if God brought judgment to the nation of Israel, so the same God will bring judgment to the church. It is the warning for us. Warning for us. So, you know, today people have started over grace, super grace, hyper grace. You know, all these doctrine is making the people to feel good. But God brings judgment. The judgment is coming. The judgment is coming. King is coming. The Lord is coming. So God said, His holiness, behold, the day shall come upon you when He will take you away, fish hook, and your posterity with fish hook. You know, we know the fishing. You know, the fishes will be very happy in the water when we put the fish hook. When the fish will come and bite, and we will take it out. So then, that is the end of the fish. That's it. But you know, the same way, God warned them. I am going to bring judgment for destruction. And they disobeyed. Then God raised Assyrians, and the Assyrians invaded the land of Israel. God allowed His own people for destruction. Assyrian came around the cities of Israel. They destroyed all the walls. You know, in those days, the big cities, they have their own, their big walls for protection. So the enemy, when they come, they have their big door and they will close the door. But the Assyrians, what they did, they destroy all the walls of the nation of Israel. And destroyed, and they went inside and killed most of the Israelites. It came true, the fulfillment in the prophecy. So Jesus said in Revelation and Matthew 24, God will bring judgment. So before God come to the earth, so God said, I will send famine. Matthew 24:7-8, if you read, God will send famine. God will send can you read Matthew 24:7-8, please?
For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be a famine, pestilence, and earthquakes in the various places.
Amen. So all these things are happening today. Nations are want to take over other nation. So China want to hold off the businesses. So they want to do evil things to other nations. They want to capture everything. Nations coming against nations. So all these things are happening today. So why God wrote the word for us at the church? So you and me at the church of the Lord, when we heard all these things, we should return to the Lord. Can you read 8, please? Matthew 24:8.
All these are the beginning of sorrows.
All these things are beginning of sorrows. So the sorrow started to begin now. It started. So the Lord expectation is you and me to come under his shadow of the wings, to take refuge, to take refuge. So if you and me to come under his shadow of the wings, you and me to be holy, you and me to be washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. We want to hold of him. We want to hold of him, to be in, to trust him, yeah, for everything. We should trust our job for the Lord. We trust our spiritual life for the Lord. We trust protection for the Lord. We should trust him. We should trust him. We should come to him. That is the invitation. So if not, God will bring destruction. So God bring destruction to the nation of Israel, but allowing the Assyrians to take control of them. But then, that is the physical destruction. But again, God warned them. When you go for captivity, again, instead of repent to the Lord, instead of repentance, they hard-hearted the Israelites. But if somebody hard-hearted, God said, your spirituality, this is the spiritual judgment. This is the spiritual judgment. You know, the first thing, the sin always enter in our heart or mind. For example, some bad thoughts, when we'll see some bad things, especially when we see some bird pictures, so the thought process will hit us. That is the first thought. So when we allow the thought, it leads the body to do the evil. So we are going against our body. So that is the second step. So when we allow the started to do the evil again and again, our spiritual life will be completely destroyed. The spiritual destruction is the final destruction. It is eternal. It is eternal. So God allowed these process in everybody's life. So when we are somewhere in the, you know, spiritual attacks, when we lost something, when we should return to the Lord. That is the expectation. But we harden the heart, our spirituality will be completely destroyed. Here God said, I overthrow some of you as God overthrow Sodom and Gomorrah. Complete destruction. Complete destruction. You know, the God probably sent several people to warn Sodom and Gomorrah. We don't know. But they never turned to the Lord. Even God sent his angels to the city. They want to return to him. So God brought complete destruction. Not only the physical destruction, it is the eternal destruction. Sodom and Gomorrah is the sign for the physical destruction as well as the evil destruction. Evil destruction. Today, you know, the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah, today a lot of Christian pastors, they preach about the homosexuality. You know, God will love everybody. Yes, God loves everybody. But you know, when somebody come to the presence of the Lord, the expectation of the Lord is to repent, to repent. People used to quote, you know, when the people, the Israelites, they brought the lady, the prostitute, to the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ and asked them, Lord, we caught her in the adultery. So now what do you want to do? Jesus, he started to write. We know the story. So everybody in his presence, so everybody, they condemn their own heart. When the presence of the Lord, if somebody come to the presence of the Lord, they know their sin to be revealed. So when somebody's sins are revealed, there's two things they can do. One, they can hard-hearten or they can repent. So then the people, they left means they hard-hearted. They don't want to repent to the Lord. Lord, we are a sinner. we need forgiveness. But only one, the woman, she was all alone. Jesus said, Jesus, you know, the word is very important. Word is very important. Can you read the word? What Jesus said to her? You know, Jesus said to her, it is the great warning to her. Jesus said, it is a great warning. Oh, women, now I forgive your sin. Now, can you read the word?
Yeah, she said, no one will... Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. 11, she said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more.
Yeah, that is the word. No, I don't want to condemn you. I forgive your sin. But sin? No more. You should not sin. No more. But now I forgave you. I forgave you. I took your sin. My own body. I am going to pay the price for you. But you should not sin again. You should not sin again. When, you know, we can invite everybody to the Lord. But when somebody come to the presence of the Lord, they should not leave their own sin. The Sodom Gomorrah sin. You know, that's why the people, the preachers today, they are not understand the word of the Lord. God accepted her. God accepted her. It means she cannot have the sin. Because he is a holy God. He forgive the sin. Why he forgive? To live a holy life. To holy life. God said, I overthrown some of you and like Sodom and Gomorrah. Complete destruction to prepare to meet your God. So God is called. See, this is Sodom and Gomorrah. Complete destruction. But now you have time to repentance. Now you have some more time. So now, ready to meet your king. So you have some more time. Not yet. You have time to repentance. God called them. But prepare to meet your king. And here he said, yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. So the spirituality of the Israelites, though God allowed them for destruction, they never went back. But a few people, you know, if you see the burning, the woods are burning. If you want to, you know, if you put some of your valuable things in the fire, so what we will do, immediately it is on the fire. So we will, you know, for example, if you think, I put it in the fire, it is in the fire by mistake. So immediately I will go and take my cell phone from the fire. So by the time, most of the things will be, fire gone. So then I want to take it off. The same way, God want to take few Israelites, they repent to the Lord. That is the, this is the vision, the prophet he saw. He saw a few people are plucked out. And you are like a firebird plucked from the burning. A few people, they will be saved from the eternal destruction. But again God said, prepare to meet your God, O Israel. Everybody in this land, everybody in this earth, everybody. If you like or not, one day we will meet the Lord. We will meet the Lord. Christ will be on the throne. Everybody will sit. He will be on the throne. We want to come before him for judgment. When we come to the presence of the Lord today in his forgiveness in his presence, asking the Lord for forgiveness. So we are judged today. As the children, today we are judged because of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we come to the presence today, So God will remove all our sins. Though our sins were, it's a dark or crimson red. So the blood of Jesus Christ will come and cleanse completely, 100%, washes. And God took the punishment. But if we are not come to today, his throne of judgment today, one day we will face. That time he will be, no, that time there is, we can't return. No, there is no repentance. You know, if you take the plague which God sent to Egypt, you know, for a few plague God allowed Pharaoh to repent. But after some time, God hardened the heart of the Pharaoh, the king Pharaoh. God hardened his heart. If God hardened somebody's heart, they can't return to the Lord. You know, for example, if you bring the butter near the flame, what will happen? The butter will melt. But if you bring the matpanda, what is that? Clay. If you bring the clay near the fire, it is hard. We can't, you know, it won't melt. The same thing, you know, when we come to the presence of the Lord today, we will be melted. And we will ask the Lord, Lord, I'm a sinner. Like, you know, prophet Isaiah in chapter 6, he was heart is melted and he asked the Lord for forgiveness. But when somebody come to the presence, if their heart is not melted, their heart is hardened. You know, that's why all the evil people, also they will quote the word for their own evil purpose. Evil purpose. You know, today, Jehovah Witness, they are quoting the word for their own purpose. The Muslim people, they are quoting the word for their own purpose. The Unitarian, they are quoting the word from their own purpose. People, they want to embrace the world. They are quoting the word. They harden their heart. Harden their heart. But one day, nobody can't escape. Bible said, prepare to meet your God, O Israel. Everybody is in this earth to meet the Lord. So let's examine our heart. Examine our heart. Today, the table is open. When we come to the presence of the Lord, with broken hearted, with melted, Lord, I am a sinner. Lord, I need my sins to be judged. Forgive me, Lord. Forgive me. When we come to the presence and asking the Lord to forgive all our sins, all our transgression, the blood of Jesus Christ will come upon us, wash us completely, and make us too worthy to stand before the Lord. Let's close our eyes and pray.